Now I have a little bit more detail on ways to solve the identification issues, starting with lab and field experiments. Randomized experiments are considered the gold standard. How do they work? First, you divide the population, these black mice, into subpopulations. They are the red mice that receive the treatment, and they are the blue mice that do not receive the treatment. The blue ones serve as the control group. Random assignment into the treatment and control group provides us with the needed counterfactual, but again, not at the individual level. We can only make comparisons at the average. We're comparing the average red mouse to the average blue mouse. Randomization makes sure that the assumptions of the regression model hold. Then the interpretation of the regression results becomes straightforward. Why is this not used all the time? Because it's oftentimes infeasible to randomize. First of all, the costs for these experiments are quite high. There might be direct or indirect costs. An indirect cost is the opportunity cost of not running the experiment. Say you randomize prices to figure out the demand function. You might lose out on some profits because some consumers would have paid more than the price they were charged in the experiment. Additionally, there might be ethical considerations that simply make it impossible to run an experiment, which is especially often true in the social sciences. And there are a couple of other reasons. How can we think about identification using more data? Here's an example of cross-sectional heterogeneity in panel data. So there's firm A, the one with the yellow data points, firm B, the one with the blue data points, and there's firm C with the red data points. All have the same slope, but different intercepts. What happens if we don't know that these data points come from different firms? Well, we have to treat them as if they were from just one firm. This is called a pooled OLS model. In such a model, we would get the solid black line, which you can see completely disregards the fact that each firm has a separate intercept. In other words, the firm effects are unobserved and become part of the error term V. This can cause estimation bias. In our example, the slope of the solid black line is much steeper than the actual slopes of the dashed lines. In more technical terms, we can say that there is a type of serial correlation between the error terms. Further, if there's a correlation between X and these unobserved firm effects, the CSs, the firm-specific intercepts, then the error term becomes correlated with X. And this biases our estimate of beta, and we get incorrect standard errors. What can we do to reduce this estimation bias? We can use a method that is called fixed effects. The idea of fixed effects is really simple. We specifically model the intercept of each group. We give firm A, firm B, and firm C their own intercepts. In our example, this perfectly fixes the problem such that we get the correct slope parameters. The way we implement the fixed effects estimator is by creating a dummy variable for each group and then estimate the CSs with regression. Fixed effects are almost like magic because they allow us to control for everything that is unobserved and firm-specific as long as it does not vary over time. Random effects are slightly more involved. Here we assume that the group-specific intercepts, the CSs, are distributed in some hyperpopulation which follows some kind of distribution. Say it is normally distributed. Instead of estimating fixed values, we treat the intercepts as a random variable, hence the name. The basic idea of the random effects estimator is that we estimate the parameters of the distribution from which the group-specific intercepts come from. That is, we estimate the mean C and the standard deviation sigma from data. In this way, we can characterize the CSs for each group S as if they were drawn from a distribution with parameters C and sigma. What are the pros and cons of random effects versus fixed effects? Because we are only estimating the parameters of the distribution of intercepts, but not the intercepts themselves, random effects needs much less data. Random effects also allows us to include group-level predictors that are constant within groups, for example firm-specific variables that do not vary over time. In a fixed effects model, these would be perfectly collinear with the group-specific intercept. A fixed effects model needs quite a lot of data. Roughly speaking, you need to estimate as many parameters as there are groups. In practice, this is often much more than the two parameters of the random effects model. In contrast to fixed effects, random effects assumes that there is no correlation between x and the intercepts. For example, we would need to assume that there is no correlation between investing in R&D and a higher firm performance. As this is often hard to justify, people typically prefer fixed effects over random effects. Also, fixed effects are quite easy to think about and very easy to implement. This might be another reason why this model is used widely in practice. Let's talk about identification using quasi-experiments. A consistent estimator can be based on instrumental variables. The idea here is to find a variable z that is correlated with x but is unrelated to the error term u. Now, the problem is that good instruments are typically hard to find. You can think of them as suggested by economic theory, they can be lagged variables that instrument for current values of the outcome, under some assumptions, and often they come from quasi-experimental variation. Here's an example of that. In Galasso and Schenkemann, they ask whether patent rights facilitate or impede follow-on innovation. And here we have an obvious endogeneity problem. Technologies with greater commercial potential are both more likely to be protected by patents and to be an attractive target for follow-on innovation. The setup in the paper is to estimate the effect of removing patent rights by court invalidation on subsequent research, as measured by later citations of the patent. The identification strategy is fairly clever. Some judges are stricter than others and therefore invalidate more patents. But the way the court system in the US works is that it randomly assigns judges to cases. So randomly, you can have a stricter judge in some cases and a more lenient judge in other cases. The results show that there are 50% more citations after invalidation, and an effect that is stronger in electronics than in biotech and stronger for small firms. What Galasso and Schenkemann estimate is the number of citations that a patent gets as a function of whether it has been invalidated and a bunch of other stuff. And they instrument this variable invalidated, the x variable, with an instrumental variable z, which in this case is a propensity of whether three judges that are randomly assigned to the case will declare the patent invalid. They construct this instrumental variable based on historical court decisions. Finally, let's talk about identification using natural experiments. One very useful tool is difference in differences. The identifying assumption is that whatever happened to the control group over time is what would have happened to the treatment group in the absence of the treatment. Sounds complicated, but it's very simple, as you will see in a minute. So you have a control group that sort of develops over time, represented by the black data points. And then you have a treatment group that also develops somewhat over time, shown by the green data points. Next, there's a treatment happening, which transforms the green data points into the red data points. Note that the red data points are all larger in the y dimension. And this is what we're interested in. We want to measure how big is the treatment effect. With the difference in differences method, we are essentially estimating the dashed line. We use the slope of the control group to predict what the treatment group would have looked like had the treatment not happened. So why is this called difference in differences? Because we first need to take care of the difference between the treatment and the control group. That is the stable constant difference between the black data points and the green data points. Then we take the difference before and after the treatment. The difference in differences then is our estimate of the treatment effect. Difference in differences is a simple two-period, two-group comparison. It is incredibly useful when the mechanism that makes some firms end up in the treatment group and others in the control group is as good as random. Kretschmer and Peukert is an example where we used this method in my research. The question in this paper was, do music videos increase or decrease the sales of recorded music? We observe weekly sales of thousands of songs, and a licensing dispute causes YouTube to block all music videos in Germany. This is the natural experiment that induces a change, and we can compare before and after. For the identification strategy, we compare sales of songs with music videos, that is, the treatment group, to sales of songs without music videos, that is, the control group, just before and after the blocking. So some of these songs now don't have music videos anymore, and the other songs are not affected by the licensing dispute because they never had music videos in the first place. We are able to show that without music videos on YouTube, sales decrease by 10%. In other words, music videos cause sales of recorded music to increase.